Belinda presents this unabridged recording of On Doubt, part of the MUP series, Little Books on Big Ideas, written by Leigh Sales and read by Louise Crawford. The beginning of wisdom is found in doubting. By doubting, we come to the question, and by seeking, we may come upon the truth. Pierre Abelard, French philosopher, teacher, and theologian, 1079 to 1142. Leigh Sales is one of Australia's most respected journalists. She anchors the ABC's flagship TV current affairs program, 7:30, and her first book, Detainee, 002, was released in 2007 to critical acclaim. She has two Walkley Awards, Australia's highest journalism honour, and also co-hosts a wildly popular podcast called Chat 10 Looks 3, about books, television and culture. 1. On the first day of primary school each year, my mother would deliver me to my new teacher with the same introduction. "If she's any trouble," Mum would say with a pointed stare in my direction, "please give her a thrashing and then send her home with a note so that I know to give her another one." Authority was to be respected. It would have been unthinkable to call my school friends' parents by their first names as children do today. And if we visited somebody's home with Mum and Dad, we were to sit quietly until invited to do otherwise. No matter how much my fingers itched to touch their piano, no matter that I was dying to make their cockatoo talk, no matter that I remembered from the previous visit that there was a calendar in the toilet showing cartoons of famous people with enormous private parts, I would not dare move until given permission. I remember a child once came to our place and demanded some cordial by simply barking, "Cordy!" My brother and I couldn't have been more than 4 and 5, but I still recall the way our heads snapped up and the look of horror we gave each other. Imagine going to a stranger's house and asking for a drink before one was offered, and not even saying please. Discipline was strict in our house, and there was no more powerful tool than Mum's threat, "I'll tell your father when he gets home." Dad was an infantryman, a regimental sergeant major by the time I was a teenager. You could see your face in his boots, and your life flashing before you in his eyes. Like most people in his line of work, the sound of his raised voice crossed a chainsaw with a starving grizzly bear. Dad and I had a volatile relationship. Although I was generally well behaved in public, I was a bit of a handful at home, mostly because I insisted on questioning everything. Dad was accustomed to giving orders to soldiers all day and being silently obeyed. Seemingly from the cradle, I had an uncontrollable urge to respond to all his directives with, "But why?" At the end of a dressing down, he would roar, "Do you understand?" I would, somewhat unwisely, often pick him up on a point or two, seeking clarification. Surprisingly, my parents did not find this at all endearing. I recall one tea time when Dad, boiling with rage, slammed his hands down on the table, gripped its edges, looked skyward, as if to God, and with a shaking voice spluttered, "Give me strength!" On another occasion, I drove Mum to such fury that she tipped a drink over my head. If I was sent to my room, a common outcome, I would wail and weep as if the world were ending. I found it hardest to hold my tongue when, in my immense 11-year-old wisdom, I considered my parents' logic to be flawed. My brother and I fought constantly, and I particularly chafed at Mum's decree that we deserved equal punishment because it takes two to fight. It doesn't take two, I would cry indignantly when hauled to my bedroom. It takes one. It takes him coming in here and slapping me when all I was doing was reading my book. I was a long, skinny kid with limbs like tentacles, and I'd resist all the way, wrapping a foot around a table leg or winding an arm through a chair. As Mum tried to stuff me into my room like a pair of shoes into an overpacked suitcase, I'd rant, "Why are you saying that it takes two? You can't explain it because you know it doesn't make sense." My back chat and constant questions didn't stem from rebellion alone. I was curious about everything. Until I was about 13, I shared a room with my nana, my mother's mother, who lived with us. There were few worse sins in her book than being a sticky beak. She had a visceral loathing of one of our neighbours, and as best I could tell, the woman's only crime was that she was apparently a sticky beak who wore too much jewellery. My father was also frequently accused of sticky beaking. "He has eyes like a hawk," Nana would rail, by no means intending it as a compliment. Nana perhaps didn't realise that she was sleeping next to the biggest sticky beak in the house. I was a chronic eavesdropper. I loved to listen to my mother on the phone with her friends and would find any excuse to skulk around the conversation. At night, after I'd been ordered to bed, I would press my ear to the bedroom wall, straining to hear Prisoner on the television set in the lounge room. Even though the program scared me witless, I couldn't bear not knowing what was happening. At school, I'd just about burst with satisfaction at discovering a teacher's first name. "It's not Mrs. Cantaruti," I'd run and tell my best friend breathlessly. "It's Vicky." Nana was a great reader of women's magazines, and I swiped them obsessively to read the advice columns. I loved them all, indiscriminately consuming advice on medical issues, parenting, sex, and relationships. I was oddly ashamed of this habit and would hide in the toilet with Nana's treasure trove, sneakily devouring people's stories and lapping up the columnist's suggestions. To this day, the addiction persists. Every day, I go to salon.com and read Since You Asked. I'm also enamoured of Dear Prudence, advice on morals and manners on slate.com. When I lived in the USA, I used to pick up a weekly local newspaper solely to read Savage Love, a hysterically funny column on kinky sexual problems. The pleasures of Dan Savage's biting wit, though, were a long way from my childhood home in the Pine Rivers Shire on the outskirts of Brisbane. A fellow politician once accused the Prime Minister, Queenslander Kevin Rudd, of joking that after you cross the Pine Rivers, you can hear the sound of banjo music, a reference to the creepy rednecks in the 1972 film Deliverance. Mr. Rudd denies it. There were no banjos in my parents' modest house, and none of us had six fingers. But the moral code was built on traditional foundations of hard work and good manners, and was strictly enforced. My parents instilled in me the classic Protestant work ethic, although they were entirely uninterested in religion, if not overtly hostile. Mum had attended Catholic schools and decided that she didn't want her children brainwashed. Accordingly, she instructed our state school principal that my brother and I were to be sent to the library during the weekly religious education class. Mum's anti-church streak bred in me an intense curiosity about religion. A few weeks after I finished grade 12, a good friend invited me to his church youth group. It started an association with Christianity that lasted several years. I attended a Pentecostal church affiliated with Hillsong, offering slick music and lots of young devotees. The church's social scene was engaging, and the Bible was interesting reading. But by my early 20s, I had serious doubts about religion, and soon after, I abandoned it altogether. My problem was not a lack of effort or a lack of desire to believe. The problem for me was a lack of faith. How do I know this is true? From almost the first day I attended church, my questions started. They were the same ones that drum away at all atheists and agnostics. How do I know God exists? How do I know the Bible is true? What is the hard evidence for this? Many of my questions concerned fairness. Is it really the case that people who don't believe all this are going to hell? Doesn't that seem a bit harsh? I sincerely wanted to be free of my inconvenient questions, but I needed answers based in reason, evidence, and logic. I poured
over the. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.